So living has been kind of tough for me. There's been some times where I would have to beg my parents for money.
Yeah, I'm from Milwaukee.
San Jose.
Home.
Hayward.
I am from Tasmania. No, I'm just kidding.
No, I'm from the East Bay.
Here in California, I am born in Alameda.
Home is in San Jose, California.
So I was born in Stockton and pretty much raised in Lodi.
I was born in St. Louis, grew up all around the country, but mainly reside in a small town called Bradenton, Florida.
I'm from a lot of places. Born in LA, raised in Mexico, and from Mexico, Seattle, and from Seattle, near San Francisco.
Home to me is a roof over my head and the people who I love and the memories that are made there.
Home is wherever I'm at that moment. I mean, if I have a house over my head and I enjoy that house, then I guess that is home.
I can just relax, take my shoes off, not worry about things.
Home is where your heart feels like it's settled there, where it's more comfortable. Once you move out of the nest, you're on your own and you gotta figure things out on your own. Support yourself, do whatever it takes.
How do I define what home is? I don't know, I don't really feel at home here. I mean, I have a house here, but I don't feel at home. Like, my home is where my family is. And I guess my friends are my family since I don't really have any, that much family out here. So wherever my friends are, that's where I kind of call home.
I grew up there and I've lived up here for 4 years. And there's nothing really left for me down there. All my friends have moved away. All the ones that matter are up here anyways.
Home is pretty much any place, because like I never get homesick. I don't have any real attachments like that. It really doesn't make a whole lot of sense to see how, you know, someone just like, oh man, I miss home. Like, really, if you have a place to sleep, it's comfortable, you know, and like, you don't, I don't know, those attachments are kind of what people just, I don't know, they allow themselves to just get taken over by that, you know, that sense of need. They're like, oh, I'm not comfortable here, but really your comfort is what's inside you. Like, it's your own, I think comfort is just it's a state of mind. So, I mean, whatever place you're at, whether you're on the top of a mountain or in the middle of a desert, if you're cool with it, you're cool with it.
It's from the school where you get your passion from?
Actually, it's at the top of my priorities. It's number one. So.
In comparison to when I started, school is number one, and now I would say it's basically the last thing on my mind.
I mean, I go to school still. I mean, I got up this morning, didn't I?
Mostly I'd go to school simply for the social interactions between people, because I think humans are very interesting, as we are.
I want to get school over and done with.
This isn't what you really feel like doing. I'd suggest, you know, go to a different school. Because right now, I'm enjoying my life here, although it's really challenging. And I see a lot of people just wasting their time and money here.
Anyone procrastinate? Because, well, I don't know.
I always put things off. I mean, not for any reason other than not feeling like doing them at that moment. I'm actually supposed to be in class right now, putting it off.
I always put things, you know, in the back burner always, because I want to do so many things.
I procrastinate with school projects because they don't interest me, mainly because I found myself learning more off school grounds on my own time other than in class.
If I'm really into it, I would put all my time and effort into it, but if I really don't care about it, then I'll procrastinate a lot. I'll do it like the night before, which a lot of students do, but I try my best not to, but sometimes it happens. Because if you just look at the word put things off, that means like you intentionally put it off, and I don't do that. I somehow forget and misplace my train of thought or things that I really need to do. It's more of, I put my backpack down and then I walked away and my backpack didn't really follow me, so it wasn't like talking or anything, so, you know, if it doesn't have my attention, I'm probably not gonna pay attention to it.
By like a large population of people or like a couple people?
Rather be hated, because hating leads to other negative things. I don't want to say negative energy because that sounds gay.
It's not like to be hated is such a bad thing. And most times when you are hated, it's usually a misunderstanding to begin with.
Jeez. Just a really negative thing. And it takes a lot. It takes a lot from you, not only physically, but spiritually.
Hated, I guess. I'm not really sure entirely, because I personally don't like a lot of people. I don't hate anyone, because hate is a very powerful word. You know, it means you just want to destroy them, if you will.
I can handle being hated. And I don't like using hate, because it's too strong of a word. I only hate one person that I will say on camera. And that is my dad.
I'm used to a lot of people liking me and just being comfortable and stuff like that.
How can I say? And people can hate you, but you don't have to care. And when you hate some person, it's like it's a really personal issue for you, and it'll consume you. So.
Becky, I wish you didn't get addicted to cocaine. It's too bad. I miss the person that you were, and the person you become, I can't even look in the face.
That's always a difficult one, because to be loved versus to love, because I mean, I've loved things that didn't love me back, and that pretty much just put me in a bad position. And to get lost in emotions, you always have to balance out emotions and logic.
The feeling of love is, it's pretty close to hate.
I know he loved me, but to a certain extent, but I was the one who loved the most, and it was just really painful. I didn't like the feeling that I was the one who was giving and giving and giving and not receiving something back.
Girls suck sometimes, but then again, so do ex-boyfriends.
I'd rather be loved, because when you love someone and it doesn't, and it's not reciprocated, it's very painful.
If you love someone and they don't love you back, that kind of sucks. I know some people who might go through that, not necessarily. Be loved, because I feel happy. You know, that's really selfish of me.
Be loved. Because the way I see it, in a relationship, you go through ups and downs, and there's a lot of times more downs than ups, but just that one moment of that person, of that special moment, makes you forget everything else, all the bad.
If you can love, you are capable of everything.
When you're talking about like a relationship or trying to build one, I always like to use the analogy of ladders to the moon, which is something I made up. It's pretty much, you like somebody. There's your structure. You know, you have the whole understanding of, okay, I like her, she might like me, and so you start building this ladder. And like, I love this person to the point where I want to take them to the moon. So you start building this ladder together, right? And it takes two people to build a ladder, but most people will sit there and be so overwhelmed with emotion that they'll just go off and build the ladder. Start going and going and going and going and going, but there's nobody on the bottom to hold your ladder. So once you realize that you built this ladder for nothing, you're up there, and it's a hard fall. When you realize that you have nobody up there on you that's holding your ladder or there to withstand the storms that you have to go through in order to reach the moon, there's nobody there, it's a hard fall.
I'd rather be loved, because then at the end of the day, if everything's falling apart, you know that there's someone out there thinking about you.
There's this guy that lives in Omaha, Nebraska. His name is Caleb Bentley. And we've known each other for like 8 years, but we never even really knew each other. We met in a chat room. And I flew out to Nebraska last year and like met him, and we had this, like, we fell in love. It was ridiculous. It was a fucking movie. Like, Paramount should have picked this shit up. And, I haven't talked to him in over 3 months, and he said he was going to come and visit me within the next couple of weeks. And, he's moved in with this girlfriend and her kid, and it never ended up happening. There was no happy ending. I'll follow you into the dark.
Because if it's like the whole population, like if the whole world who hates you,
That would be stupid. Like, what kind of question is that? That doesn't even make sense. The whole world hates you. Of course you'd rather hate someone. Like, you could hate Adolf Hitler or something. Of course, he was a vegetarian and he did paint, so he was kind of cool. But besides the whole, like, anti-Semitism or what is it? Semitism? Semitism? Kind of like Mel Gibson. It's close to me. Something evil's looking in the dark. Ooh. I'll tell you, Tong, he had, like, one testicle. And I don't know why I tell you that. Cannibalistic nurse. What was it? What do you, when you have sex with dead people? Thriller, thriller night. You're fighting for your life inside a thriller, chiller tonight. I think it goes like that.